The nation of Qatar has historically been a funder of terrorism.
The United States and Qatar will do more to keep the region and our homeland safe.
And it is our hope that Qatar will change its policies to stop terrorism, terror financing, harboring of terrorists.
Enough is enough.
Our interests with Qatar converge somewhat more often than they actually diverge.
Qatar must cut ties with terrorists.
As confusing as the Middle East itself is the sovereign state of Qatar. Bordered by Saudi Arabia to the south and surrounded by the Persian Gulf elsewhere, the peninsula is an enigma, currently at odds with its fellow countries in the Gulf Cooperative Council. Home to 313,000 citizens, with the highest per capita income in the world, Qatar has been isolated and sanctioned by neighbors who accuse it of harboring terrorists, financing terrorism, spreading propaganda through its Al Jazeera news network, and cooperating with Iran, the largest state sponsor of terrorism in the world.
40 people are dead, between 80 and 100 wounded.
This weekend, this time it is an American soldier.
Tonight, Islamic Jihad, which means holy war, claims to have planted the explosive.
Qatar is very rich. It has a tremendous oil and natural gas resources, but it has an indigenous population of only 313,000 people. When it became independent in the 1970s, its population was only 45,000. So they actually have much more resources than they have people.
Qatar is an extremely wealthy country today, and with billions, if not trillions of dollars of gas money still under Qatari territory. The problem is they have virtually unlimited wealth.
Now, a nation like that could actually build tremendous prosperity for itself and probably for others, and could have lots of respect from others based on what they do for them. Instead, what they want to do is compete with the larger neighbors in the region, especially Saudi Arabia, and they want to establish themselves as some sort of the major country in the Muslim world. And instead of doing that by appealing to the moderate sentiment of the Muslims of the world, they are trying to do that by embracing the most extreme interpretations of Islam.
There is a list of radical groups that the Qataris support. It includes the Taliban. It includes Nusra Front financiers. This is the Al-Qaeda group from Syria. It includes the Muslim Brotherhood. It includes jihadists in Libya, and more broadly, sort of extremists from across the Arab world. If you have enough money, you think you can get yourself out of any trouble that you put yourself into. And I don't think money is going to get him out of this one.
What Qatar is trying to do is that it's a small country trying to punch above its weight. And in doing so, it is empowering groups that can destabilize the entire Islamic world and can have us all involved in a clash of civilizations for decades, if not centuries.
At the same time, Qatar pushes for an alliance with the West, hosting Al Udeid Air Base, headquarters of the United States Air Force's Central Command, and the 83rd Expeditionary Air Group of Great Britain's Royal Air Force.
Qataris, on the one hand, consider themselves to be strong allies of the United States. They host our largest air base in the Middle East, and we carry out attacks against ISIS and Al-Qaeda from this base in Qatar known as Al Udeid. On the other hand, they are supporting groups like the Taliban and the Nusra Front. So they're playing both sides in the war on terrorism. This has not played well in the Arab world.
Qatari leaders continue to sign accords, enter agreements, and promise reforms to end financial and logistical support for terrorists and terrorism, groups like the Taliban and Al-Qaeda, who operate freely out of Doha and use business and financial institutions to support radical Islam and global jihad.
Qataris have been supporting movements across the Middle East that are Islamist in nature, that are anti-establishment in nature, and that they have really been a force for instability across the Middle East.
The more Qatar puts money into the coffers of those who are behaving badly, the more it enables their bad behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Qatar is both an ally and an adversary of the United States. This is the role that Qatar has been playing for the last 20 years at least. They continue to support and deal with a lot of bad actors.
The Muslim Brotherhood is the mothership of radical Islamism. The Muslim Brotherhood was founded in 1928 in Egypt. They said that they want to restore the supremacy of Islam, but they always had a violent streak. And in recent years, that violent streak has come back.
The Cooperation Council of the Arab States of the Gulf, also known as the Gulf Cooperation Council, or GCC, was established in 1981 as a regional, intergovernmental, political, and economic union. From the beginning, Qatar has been an outlier.
What was the reason for the GCC states, these six small oil-rich countries, to come together? Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, and Oman. What brought them together a quarter of a century ago? Fear of the larger neighbors, Iran and Iraq. That was a fear. That was the basis for these countries to get together. At some point, it seems that Qatar wanted to be the smart one in the group among the GCC states. They decided the future of this region is something called Islamic, or the Islamist Brothers, or the Muslim Brothers as they call it.
The Gulf Cooperation Council has cited Doha's ongoing support for the Muslim Brotherhood and other extreme Islamist groups as a reason for the sanctions they have placed on Qatar.
Almost every Sunni Islamist terrorist group has come out of the Muslim Brotherhood.
At one point in their foreign policy, the Qatari elite basically decided to gamble and support the Muslim Brothers.
The Muslim Brotherhood was born in Egypt in the late 1920s. It was a violent organization designed to overthrow Western influence in Egypt, but it quickly spread to other countries around the Middle East. Fast forward to today, the Muslim Brotherhood ideology is the cornerstone of most of the violent Islamist ideologies that we see in our so-called war on terrorism. It's the cornerstone of the Al-Qaeda ideology. In fact, the co-founder of Al-Qaeda with Osama bin Laden was a Muslim brother. We see Muslim Brotherhood ideology informing ISIS.
Some of the harshest extremist groups in Syria, Al-Qaeda's top leadership also sought inspiration from the Muslim Brotherhood. Many Muslim Brotherhood members are involved in assassinations, terrorist plots, and violent extremist actions and exhortations. So in many cases, Muslim Brotherhood preachers are not engaging in terrorist acts themselves, but their words are serving as inspiration and exhortation to others to do that. That is why the Muslim Brotherhood has been described as a terrorist group or a terrorist enabler by countries including Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. The Muslim Brotherhood are often found responsible for financing specific terror plots or facilitating people who end up joining extremist groups. There are other Muslim Brotherhood related funders who live in Qatar, operate out of Qatar, and basically, while raising money ostensibly for charitable causes, they also end up being a conduit for funding for extremist groups. In Syria, for example, Al-Nusra, which is considered affiliated to Al-Qaeda, is seen as a Muslim Brotherhood front. And fundraising for that has been very open in Qatar. We are talking about hundreds of millions of dollars in funding for various offshoots, charities, and groups affiliated with the Muslim Brotherhood that also play a role as either enablers, facilitators, or motivators of terrorist groups.
Some of these charities are supporting terrorism operations within Syria.
Turkey and Qatar have become sorts of allies in keeping the Muslim Brotherhood not only alive, but facilitating it throughout the Muslim world, especially the Middle East. The Muslim Brotherhood will benefit from Qatari largesse and will continue to cause trouble across the Middle East. And as long as there is trouble in the greater Middle East, America will not be completely safe.
Qatar is an extremely problematic ally for the United States.
The Turks and the Qataris believe that the Muslim Brotherhood is the way forward for the Middle East. They see regime change across the board. They see Islamism as their number one goal, and they believe that they will be the conduits and the leaders for it.
The most important things that the United States should be concerned about regarding Qatar is the way it interacts with its GCC neighbors.
And I think the United States should certainly be concerned about Turkey, which is a NATO member, aligning itself with Qatar.
As these movements potentially take hold across the Middle East, this will be their means to power, the blend of democracy and Islam. It is Islamism with suits and votes. This is their vision. The problem is that it is still a hateful ideology. In my view, it is a destabilizing ideology.
Turkey and Iran are now responsible for weakening the Arab blockade against Qatar. If they had not joined hands with Qatar, then Qatar would have had to negotiate with Saudi Arabia and its other Arab neighbors and modify its behavior. It is in some ways a coalition of the badly behaved.
Take a look at where the Brotherhood has already come to power to get a sense of what it might look like. For example, Egypt, where the Muslim Brotherhood was in power for a year under Mohamed Morsi, it was gross mismanagement. We saw a huge amount of money being thrown down the tubes. They were simply not ready to govern Egypt, and as a result, you saw this implosion ultimately leading to a counter coup, which was supported by many, many Egyptians.
Further empowering the alliance between Turkey and Qatar, the two have collaborated on a military base in Doha, the first for Turkey in the Persian Gulf. Ahmet Demirak, Turkey's ambassador to Qatar, claimed the base is part of a defense agreement between the two countries to help confront common enemies. The question, of course, is who are the common enemies?
A Qatar-Turkey alliance manifested in a Turkish military base in Qatar will be a threat to all those Arab countries that have been recognizing Qatar as not only a bad actor, but a threat to their own security.
But this is unfortunately the way that Qatar moves. They play both sides of the fence almost all the time, and this is what they've been doing with the United States.
In other words, Qatar and Turkey are tactical partners, and the one thing that pulls them together is that the common understanding that Muslim Brothers are here to stay. And as I said, at times they have actively supported Muslim Brothers by providing financial support, diplomatic cover, and clearly facilities on their home soils for the Muslim Brothers to operate from.
Qatar is able to project more power by playing both sides of the fence, being able to win different concessions, different accommodations from people.
This alliance between Qatar and Turkey that the Arab states have identified as being a tandem in support of this wide range of extremist groups, Muslim Brotherhood groups across the Middle East.
Playing the spoiler is a more convenient role for them. American support is very important for Qatar, and Qatar does serve some very useful purposes for the United States, including hosting the Al Udeid air base. Qatar also has a long history of supporting people who want to kill Americans.
Anywhere where Sunni radical Islamism is operational and has a significant operation going, we find the footprint of Qatar, either through money or through facilitating individuals who have a safe haven. The United States needs to hold Qatar and anybody else responsible for the actual end result, compliance with the letter of the law. Without complying with the spirit of it, should not be accepted.
Iran and Turkey today are helping Qatar as part of the blockade that Qatar faces. They are taking advantage of the disunity that is now found in the Gulf Cooperation Council. The Qataris are not calling the shots. They're not telling the Iranians and Turks what to do. It's the other way around.
I mean, I would describe the Qatari-Iranian relationship as an uneasy relationship. The Qataris, I think, have asked for the United States to put a base in their country, primarily because they're concerned about an aggressive Iran. On the other hand, we've heard rumors that the Qataris have worked with Iranian proxies, whether it be Hezbollah or even the Houthis or the Salah forces in Yemen, that may have led to the death of both Emirati and Saudi forces. If this is the case, then this would certainly be, I think, the precipitating event for this boiling over of tensions.
We're 3 months into this conflict that Qatar has with the likes of Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates. One of the key concerns that those neighbors of Qatar have had and continue to have is Qatar's relations with Iran. And now the Qataris are returning their ambassador to Tehran 3 months after this dispute began. It kind of signifies that Doha is saying, you know what, I'm doubling down. I'm not going anywhere. And I'm going to pursue my own foreign policy the way I see fit.
It might be something to be concerned about. How close are the Iranians and the Qataris getting?
They're looking at Qatar's isolation and trying to see if they can score points as part of the competition for power that is occurring across the Middle East.
Of course, we do also have to keep in mind that Qatar and Iran share an enormous natural gas field, the South Pars field. So, of course, Qatar is going to have relations with Iran in one way or another.
One of the things that has always puzzled me is here is Iran and Qatar basically engaged in a proxy conflict in Syria because they happen to support different sides in that conflict. And yet, the Iranians never really say anything bad about Qatar. There are never really threats made by Iran against Qatar the way the Iranians oftentimes make threats against some of the other GCC states. It's a difficult one to explain away. So I'm pretty sure much is happening behind the curtain.
The Qatari-Irani relationship is also rather strange. On the one hand, Qatar argues that we would rather be a channel for peace with Iran. And after all, Iran is a neighbor of ours in the sense that it's very close to us. But on the other hand, they make it very difficult to isolate Iran, which is what the other Arab countries would like to do.
Qatar is going on its own, freelancing, dabbling at times in what its Arab neighbors consider to be dangerous foreign policy pursuits. Because fundamentally, the likes of Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, do not trust Iranian intentions. And they feel that Qatar might just be the weak link in this and enable Iranian influence on the Arabian Peninsula, where they all collectively sit.
By maintaining that relationship, Qatar becomes an enabler of Iran's extremist policies. At a time when the rest of the world is trying to isolate Iran, any effort to try and hold out a lifeline to Iran from the region is dangerous.
Iran should not be forgotten. Is also right now in a close tactical relationship with the Russians. So it's not just Turkey and Iran, but it's also Russian intentions, because Russia's never had much of a military presence certainly in the Persian Gulf region. Could this be a moment for the Russians to move south? It's really difficult to see. Logically, I would say that's impossible. The Qataris would never go that far. But emotions are running high, and this is, end of the day, a family feud. And family feuds, as we all know, can be some of the nastiest out there. So that makes it very unpredictable.
The international community has tried to pressure Iran is by making sure that it does not have access to hard currency. Qatar becomes the enabler there by providing them the large amounts of money that Iran needs, which then are used in Syria for destabilizing Syria, in Lebanon for continuing a virtual civil war by having a militia defy the government, and it's also available for destabilizing the peace process in Palestine.
They share the largest natural gas field in the world. Half of it sits in Iranian territory, the other half sits in Qatari territory. 15% of the world's gas, right there. That makes them partners, whether they like it or not. They have to figure out how to exploit all that gas because there's, as I said, trillions of dollars sitting down there. But it's always going to be a difficult relationship. The Qataris don't want to see what happened to Kuwait in 1990 when Saddam invaded that country to happen to them by having the Iranians invade Qatar. So they have to walk a very fine line, and they do. But the criticism from Qatar's neighbors is, you're doing more than just walking a fine line here. You're actually accommodating Iran at times.
This is Al Jazeera.
The problem with Al Jazeera is one that I think American officials and Western officials should be more concerned about, and that is that the Al Jazeera has long been a mouthpiece for some of the more radical voices in the Middle East.
Straddling the line between news and propaganda, Al Jazeera Arabic, according to Hussein Ibish of the Arab Gulf States Institute, flirts with the promotion of violence. According to The Economist, the network champions extremist viewpoints, broadcast messages from terrorists and terror organizations, including Youssef al-Qaradawi, a radical Islamic theologian who advocates violence on his own talk show.
Immediately after 9/11, the first time that many Americans and others heard of Al Jazeera, they understood that it was effectively Osama bin Laden's bulletin board, where they would post different bin Laden or other al-Qaeda videos threatening Americans, threatening fire and brimstone.
When you talk about trying to fight jihadism and the ideology that powers it, Al Jazeera has fomented those problems. It has exacerbated those problems. So we see the messages from al-Qaeda, from ISIS on Al Jazeera. On top of that, you also see a strident anti-Saudi, anti-GCC establishment voice, which is often what has been the thorn in the side of the Saudis and the GCC.
When it first started, soon it became apparent that Al Jazeera had very specific agendas. It was selectively truthful. It also ended up becoming the channel through which Osama bin Laden sent his messages to the rest of the world. And in recent years, all extremist groups managed to find a greater resonance with Al Jazeera than do those advocating moderation in the Muslim world.
One person who is not afraid to die can start a revolution, but it is only when hundreds and then thousands have lost their fear that a revolution becomes inevitable.
Qatar should not have used Al Jazeera to destabilize other countries.
If you go downtown Doha and you look at the number of journalists who work for Al Jazeera, many of them are Muslim Brothers sympathizers. Many of them are members of that organization. Clearly, a very different political path here chosen by Qatar than its neighbors in elsewhere in the GCC.
Several Al Jazeera correspondents have had Muslim Brotherhood links. And the actions of Al Jazeera have been challenged by some of its own former employees who say that it wanted them to behave and act in manners that were put them at risk for being terrorists.
But when you actually look at the Arabic language programming, for example, in recent years, I think you could make a pretty good case that its programs have fueled the sectarian conflict in the Middle East. The sort of sectarian message that comes from some of these speakers and some of the staff, frankly, who work for Al Jazeera as journalists is quite upsetting to watch.
Al Jazeera is not your regular conventional news organization, but something that can be considered a veritable arm of Qatar's policy of trying to get greater hearing for the Muslim Brotherhood in the Muslim world. There are several people who come on Al Jazeera who have either been considered terrorists, terror enablers, terrorist financiers, or terrorist instigators.
You know, if you believe, as I do, sectarianism is one of the most dangerous plagues right now in the Middle East, then a platform as important and as resourceful as Al Jazeera should not be engaging in promoting sectarianism. But I believe that's exactly what Al Jazeera Arabic can be accused to have done.
Look, I think that there was probably a moment during the Bush administration where they were very clearly viewing Al Jazeera as part of the enemy.
Do you want to yell? Or do you want to have an interview?
No,
you have a choice. You have a choice.
You're
being true to form.
No, but
yes,
I'm,
you
I'm
are.
Asking
no,
you,
say
Mr.
yes once.
I'm
just say
you.
Yes
I'm
once.
I'm asking you. Do you think that the numbers you went into Iraq, the numbers of U.S. troops that you went into Iraq with, did absolve you from the responsibility of tens, maybe hundreds of thousands of innocent Iraqis killed?
Now, are you going to stop?
Give me a straight answer.
Look, you can characterize my answers any way you want. And you do it in a pejorative way.
No, I'll do it respectfully.
No, you don't at all. You're obviously, you are of that nature.
Don't talk about that.
You're not being respectful. You're just talking over and over and over.
Well, you have just disparaged me as a member of Al Jazeera, but that's okay. Just give me a straight answer.
How did I disparage you? I said you're not being respectful. You're just talking over and over and over, and that's what you're doing.
Okay, I'll listen.
Anyone listening to this program can see that.
There was a moment where, at least according to some officials, there was talk of taking out Al Jazeera assets. That is probably no longer the case now, that they see Al Jazeera as exercising its right to free speech. The problem is that it does seem to be fomenting, exacerbating, and adding to the challenge of radical Islam. There's one preacher by the name of Yusuf Kardawi, who is the man who has largely normalized, and he's had a regular show over the years, and he's a regular guest on Al Jazeera. It's things like that that really get under the skin of those who are fighting the ideology of extremism.
Al Jazeera also allows some of the most extreme interpretations of Islam to be presented to its viewers, instead of allowing a variety of Islamic interpretations being discussed and letting the viewers realize that Islam as it is practiced in most countries has some regional, local, and even philosophical differences, and that difference must be celebrated by presenting Islam as only one option and one way of Islam to the people. Al Jazeera does a disservice.
You won't see them advocating for violence institutionally. It's implied throughout their programming. It's endorsed tacitly in much of their programming. It's highly problematic. I think it needs to be called out for what it is. I don't see it as being that different from, RT, for example, Russian television. It's a propaganda outlet for the Qataris. It's a means for them to extend their power and to make sure that their voice is being heard. Qataris are spreading money around to wherever they can, wherever there is an opportunity to spread that Muslim Brotherhood ideology and to empower the Brotherhood. It's right on the table. Same with the Taliban. They're not trying to cover their tracks. This is providing support to terrorist groups in the way that very few others would dare do.
As clear as Qatar's alliance with the United States, hosting Abu Dhabi Air Base, home for more than 10,000 U.S. troops, is that nation's overt support for terrorists and terrorism. Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, Muslim Brotherhood, the Nusra Front, and the Taliban. These are a few of the beneficiaries of billions of dollars in financial assistance and supplies. And according to experts, Qatar is also harboring more than a dozen sanction-designated or wanted individuals. Terrorists like Yusuf Al-Qaradawi of the Muslim Brotherhood, three operatives of the Taliban currently under sanction by the United Nations, and at least seven Al-Qaeda financiers.
It is a dangerous alliance. It is an insane arrangement that we would have our most important airbase down the street from Taliban leaders, from Nusra financiers, and from Muslim Brotherhood figures. This is the kind of thing that I think only emboldens our adversaries and enemies. It weakens our alliances, and I think it demonstrates to the world that we're not really terribly resolved to fight these ideologies in the way that we say that we are.
Qatar is not the first small country to try and act as a big power. We saw that in the behavior of Cuba. We have occasionally seen it in the behavior of certain other smaller countries wanting to be seen as big, trying to remove the asymmetry of size by asymmetry of actions. That always ends up causing trouble. I remember how Cuba ended up becoming an international player by arming insurgents and terrorist groups in Africa and many other places, instead of saying, we are a small country with a small population, but with a lot of money, and we can use that money to become identified with the greatest generosity and philanthropy around the world. Instead, they choose to support radicalism as a means of getting influence. The only way to deal with a small actor on the world stage that wants to punch above its weight is to try and keep it in its place. When alliances are forged with a state like Qatar, then its behavior definitely gets amplified.
What Qatar has is plenty of money in the bank because it happens to sit on top of one of the largest gas reserves in the world. With billions, if not trillions of dollars of gas money still under Qatari territory, that will be available to whoever controls that country.
The problem is they have virtually unlimited wealth. It's not as if we can get financial leverage over them. The alliance is one in which the Qataris have seemingly more leverage over the United States than we have over Qatar. They need our base there in order to protect them as much as we need the base in order to fight ISIS and Al-Qaeda. But what's happened over time is that we have become so accustomed to this base and we've grown so enamored with this base that we've been unwilling to challenge the Qataris with the behavior that we've documented here, this support for terrorism.
Qatar certainly projects a certain amount of influence around Washington because of the money it spends. I wrote an article a couple of years ago about the amount of money that Qatar gives to the Brookings Institution. So I believe a little less than $15 million or a gift that it gave.
We all know that lobbying all over the world, and especially in Washington, is a game of money. Think tanks, universities, even media organizations receive or accept funding for research, for conferences, and Qatar has been involved in all of that for several years.
The Qataris have a lot of assets in Washington. They have lobbyists, they have universities, they've got think tanks, and they've got other influencers, including even a few journalistic outlets that continue to push their narrative. And this is what has made it so difficult to counter what they're doing, because they've got so many people messaging in the other direction. So we can point out the support for terrorism, the blind eye for extremists within their own borders, the destabilization of the rest of the Middle East. But for every message that I might send on those problems, the Qataris have many other messengers inside Washington to counter that with some other narrative.
Over the last decade or so, the Qataris have put all their eggs in as many baskets as they can find in the Middle East. You cannot be on everyone's side all the time and getting away with it. And at one point or another, you're going to upset somebody, and this is what's happened. There's a reason why they wanted that American military base on their soil. And it's not because they just simply want to be good friends with the United States. They think that base is their security. Qatar cannot afford to be an adversary to the United States. Its security depends on US goodwill.
The power dynamic between the United States and Qatar, in my view, needs to change. We need to start to talk about how we're willing to move the base if the Qataris don't comply, that we're willing to perhaps disperse some of our assets and create new bases in Kurdistan or the UAE or Jordan. This is the alternative to what the Qataris have arranged right now.
They are engaging in the folly of thinking that they can light fires outside and those fires will not consume them. The United States must definitely engage much more robustly with Qatar and either try to modify its behavior, even if it involves telling them that our base being here is not in any way your license to bad behavior towards your neighbors. The United States must hold Qatar responsible for money emanating from Qatar that ends up in the hands of terrorists.
They are capable. They certainly can engage in reform. We've seen inklings of their willingness to work with the West, whether it be kicking out extremist figures that are inside the country, or adopting new laws, or even prosecuting certain figures within the country.
A series of steps the two countries will take over the coming months and years to interrupt and disable terror financing flows and intensify counterterrorism activities.
The extreme ideas, once they are implanted into the heads of people, cannot be taken out. I think that that is a mistake, and I think it's a mistake for the United States to keep tolerating it, because an airbase can be relocated.
It is ultimately in their interest if they're to be taken seriously. If they want to be major players in the financial community or in just world politics, that they're going to have to stop this activity. We need to make sure that all of these countries are held to account, and specifically held to account on terrorism finance. But I believe that it starts with Qatar.